Welcome viewers, in this program we are going to discuss strategies about research publication. Friends, as we all know that research is a very important component of our profession, and research publications carries a lot of weight and importance in the development of our career. In this program we are going to discuss what are the different types of research papers and research articles that can be there, what are the different kinds of journals which are there, and what are the common problems which are related to publishing in a high quality journal. Then towards the end we are going to discuss two very important and relevant things, namely the citation index of an author and the impact factor of a journal. So friends, I am sure that you must have written many research papers in your career so far, and this particular program may be a soft reminder for how to go about the whole process, what kind of strategies we should be following when it comes to publishing in a good quality journal. First and foremost, we should be able to understand and distinguish among different types of publications which are possible. To begin with, we can have a general article. It is quite similar to those articles which are published in newspapers and magazines. But then proceeding further, we can have some short communications. We can have some research articles also. Now the question will come to your mind, what is the difference between general article and a research article? In a general article, we will be talking about the contemporary issues, we may be describing some of the events that might have happened, but in a research article, we will go a stage higher and then we will try to explain the phenomena also, we will try to analyze the context in which that event has happened, and we may also like to find out that some kind of references that are included in your research article. So, those authors who have done similar work or related work in the past, then you have referred to them, you have cited them, and then you have prepared a research article. Research article will be in such a manner that it is contemporary, it is of recent phenomena, it is capable of generating some interest in the readership and audience. Friends, we move further. And then the third category of publication will be the review paper. Now this review paper is a very serious exercise. As you know that the exploratory research that we carry out, we go to different kinds of secondary sources such as the databases, electronic databases, CD-ROMs, etc. We refer to the hard copy of the journals and all, we refer to the books, we refer to the websites, company reports, trade journals, conference proceedings, so many sources of the secondary data are available. And so then the papers that we are writing based on the review of the material that is available to us, that is called a review paper. Now this review paper is not complete until and unless you are able to interpret and you are able to come out with some meaning. Meaning in the sense that what you can interpret out of this review, what kind of conclusions you can arrive at, what kind of research gaps that you can identify, and what more importantly, what kind of synthesis that you can write and understand and then present in your paper. And so this review paper will be a serious research exercise, and fourth category will come, that will be a empirical research paper. As we know very well that empirical research papers are those where we have collected primary data, we have done some exploration, so some secondary data is also used, but the extent or intensity of use of secondary data is definitely not as much as it was in case of review papers. But then in empirical research, we develop our own questionnaire, we develop our own instrument, we go to the field, collect data, then bring it back, then analyze it in line with the objectives of our research, and then present those findings and draw conclusions and suggestions which are grounded from the data of the study, primary data of the study particularly. And so, such papers will be called empirical research papers. So, friends, we have talked about the general articles, then research articles, then review papers, and then empirical research papers. There are some more specialized kind of papers that are possible. One can be a case study. You select one particular organization and then you study a particular phenomena or particular problem in depth with regard to that organization itself. For example, you have chosen Indian Railways and now you are trying to find out the profitability of Indian Railways in the last decade or so, and so that can become a case study of one particular organization. So, these are some of the possibilities. Friends, we should also be able to understand that sometimes we go to a conference and we make a presentation in that conference. Now, that as a result of that presentation, some senior academics, they offer some suggestions, they offer some criticism also. And so, when you come back and then in the light of those suggestions and criticism, if you rewrite that paper again, and so then you can publish that paper also, but giving the footnote or reference that the earlier draft of this paper was presented in so and so conference in at such and such place at such and such time. And so, that kind of acknowledgement will be needed. And once this paper is ready after the in the light of those suggestions, then you can send it for publication elsewhere. So, if you have got an idea and understanding about what are the different types of publication which are possible, then we can move on to our next segment, that is, what are the different types of journals and what are the common types of problems which are encountered when we want to send our papers to those journals. Like we have different kinds of publications, we have different kinds of journals as well. First category of journal is that journal which is having ISSN number. Now, there used to be those journals in the past also which were not even having ISSN number earlier, but then now we hardly come across any journal which is not having ISSN number. So, friends, my sincere advice is that we should never ever send any paper for publication anywhere where neither ISSN is there nor ISBN is there, because that is not going to carry any kind of weightage in your research career. Friends, we should go for ISSN, but that is the basic minimum, the bare minimum thing, because the next stage is that if the journal having ISSN number is also a refereed one. Now, many a times this question arises, what is a refereed journal? And sometimes we also come across those kind of description in the journal, such as it is a double blind peer review journal. So, what is that? Double blind peer review is that the paper that you have submitted, the cover sheet of that paper is removed. So, that is now available for blind review, and double means it will go to two reviewers, and peer means that it will go to our academic community friends only. And so, this is called double blind peer review process is there. That is the more or less the similar process that is followed in refereed journals, because refereed journals are the same that where the refereeing takes place, where the submission that you make to those journals, that is sent to referees for their comments and all. So, we have noted that first and the we can say the insignificant or ineligible category is those journals without ISSN, which are to be discarded. Second category is those journals which are having ISSN number. Similarly, we can aim for publishing in books also. So, books should have ISBN number. Then we have come across this refereeing process, that those journals which are following the double blind peer review procedure. So, those are refereed journals. Naturally, when we go for this API calculations and all, and the framework which is prescribed by UGC and which is subject to change from time to time. So, we find that once we move from lower level to higher level, the API marks to be awarded goes on increasing. And then, friends, in this hierarchy, the next category comes, those are the indexed and abstracted journals. Now, you will be wondering as to what is meant by this indexing and abstracting. Friends, as we know that the purpose of writing a research paper is that it is made available to other research scholars also, if they are going to make use of this particular research publication in their own research work. And so, until and unless our publication gets circulated, widely circulated, then people will not be able to get access to that journal. So, that is why these abstracting and indexing services, they provide lot of opportunities for our papers to be noticed by other researchers, and as a result of which the citations would increase. And so, there are many abstracting and indexing agencies. One such agency which is known as Scopus. Now, Scopus is, this service was provided by elsewhere, and it was started in 2004. Then subsequently in 2009, it was decided that the decision to include any journal in the Scopus list is left to an independent agency, because elsewhere itself is a publishing house. So, to avoid the conflict of interest, this decision was taken in 2009. At the moment, there are more than 36,000 titles registered with Scopus, but out of that somewhere around 23,000 titles are active so far, and remaining 13,000 titles are not so active. But Scopus is only one. There are so many journals of life science, medical science, social science, humanities, which are associated with Scopus. Similarly, we have other electronic databases which are offering the abstracting and indexing facilities, and particularly in the field of science, where it is even more popular, and such agencies such as Web of Science etc. are there, ResearchGate and so on. So, if the third category of journal that is there, that these are the abstracted and indexed journals. And so, definitely these journals carry much more weightage than the simple process of refereeing itself. And so, a journal can have ISSN, can have the refereeing process, and then can be abstracted and indexed as well. Friends, we will be also focusing in later part of the program to discuss about what are the strategies, how to get published in such kind of high quality journals. But then, as I said, that even this is not, this list is not stopping there, because then we know that there are some agencies, for example, our higher education body in our country, University Grants Commission, they have got their own UGC list of journals, and this list is also dynamic, because the journals get included and journals get deleted also. So, at the time of publishing our journal, we have to make a note of it, that whether that journal is there in the UGC list or not. And you should not believe any agency, but you should be actually going to the UGC site and checking for yourself that whether such and such journal which they are claiming to be in the UGC list, it is there or not. Match with the ISSN number, note down the UGC list serial number, and be sure that you are publishing your paper in the proper journal only. Even UGC list is not the end of it, because then particularly in the field of management, commerce and social sciences, that we can have one more category, that is called ABDC list. Now, ABDC list is Australia Business Dean Council's list. ABDC has got four category of journals in their profile, and first and topmost category is called A star. Now, this A star is the topmost category of ABDC list, where top 5 to 7% of the journals fall into that category. Then we have A A grade list where we have 13 to 14% of the journals are there. Then we have the B category list where next 40% are there, and then finally the C category list where remaining somewhere around 28 to 30% of the journals fall in this C category. So again, I want to repeat that the ABDC categorizes journals into four categories, starting from A star, then goes to A, then B, then C, and based on that the journals are categorized. But then it is very prestigious even to publish in our C category journal as well. Now friends, we have got many more such categorization and ranking and classification, but I want to also touch upon one more particular issue, that what about e-journals? Because sometimes we may get offers of publishing in e-journals, so should we go ahead with that or not? You might notice that e-journals have a separate ISSN number, which is called e-ISSN number, and a particular journal might have a dual mode, that they might be coming with the print version as well as the electronic version also. And so again, our guiding principle would be that take the ISSN number, check it with any of these prestigious sources. It could be Emerald, it could be Springer, it could be Scopus, it could be ABDC, so whatever, and or UGC list, whatever. And so if you find, if you are convinced that yes, this journal is a genuine one, so then you can go ahead with publication in that journal also. So these were the different types of journals which are available to you. So far we have been talking about the different types of publications that are possible and different types of journals. Now how we should go about it? Friends, once we are writing a paper, then even before we have actually started writing it, maybe you can identify a journal and you can go through the recent publications or abstracts published in that, in the previous issues of that journal, to find out what are the thrust areas or hot topics of that journal. Then try to match your paper with that theme. And then one more thing which normally we don't do, but I recommend that we can write a pre-submission query to the editor of that journal, mentioning that we have got this, we are working on this particular paper, and we try to give the importance of the paper you are going to write, that for example, it is the first such attempt in South Asia or whatever. So then if the editor gives you the green signal that yes, go ahead and we might be interested in it, then you can continue with that journal. Or otherwise, if the editor politely says that you may have to look elsewhere, and so you may have to actually go somewhere else. But then friends, you should be careful that we have to go for the journal in such a manner that once we have identified the journal, pre-submission query is also successful, then definitely go to the site of that journal, find out the guidelines for authors, and strictly, very strictly follow them. Each journal has their own distinct set of guidelines regarding the nomenclature, regarding the cover page, regarding the keywords, regarding the citations, referencing style, and so on. And so even your first draft should comply with these instructions, otherwise it will be very difficult for you to match those kind of things later on. And once you have got the first draft ready, go for the second draft and do it yourself, and then later on you can think in terms of doing pre-testing of it. Pre-testing in the sense that the team of authors, co-authors and all, you are having an insider view, but then give it to someone else, someone outsider, and then get his or her fresh perspective, and that will give you many suggestions to be incorporated. Once you are convinced that this is a good publication, then very important thing, that read the guidelines of journals carefully. If they have got any plagiarism policy, then you should get your article tested for plagiarism and enclose a report of that. Even if a journal is not asking for that, you can do it yourself. The common software like Turnitin you can use for preparing plagiarism report and all. Once the paper is communicated, generally you will be given a unique number using which you will be able to track the progress. The journal will send it to the reviewers. You can also suggest some names of the reviewers whom the journal can consider for reviewing your paper, and particularly if it is a highly specialized topic. So, giving this list of reviewers who are appropriate will be very helpful. Once the paper is gone to the referees, then their comments will come, and take those comments very seriously and revise the paper on the lines of those comments and resubmit it again. So, that is where I think this process will go on and on like that, and finally, your paper may be accepted. Now, we touch upon the second last aspect, that is, what is the citation index. In case of citation index, this is actually the way that we can measure the quality of research paper written by an author as well as the quality of research work done by a particular academician. And this citation index basically is calculated on the basis of number of times that article has been cited by other research workers who are working in this particular area. And this citation index is reflected, mathematically reflected in terms of H index. Now, this H index is calculated by Google Scholar and so many other sources, and this H index is basically calculated in terms of that how many times your how many of the top papers have been cited. For example, if H index is 8, then we have to go for the number of papers, your 8 papers have got more than 8 citations. So, that is why your H index score is 8. The impact factor of the journal is based on the citation index of the authors which are publishing in that particular journal. And this impact factor of a journal is calculated in terms of this particular criteria, that what are the total number of papers which were in the previous 2 years which were cited by other research workers, vis-a-vis what are the total number of citable papers which are there. And so, this proportion will tell us about the impact factor of a journal, and all these things are highly quantitative. These were earlier applicable for science, but now they are equally applicable for social science and management as well. So, we have to take note of these things. Friends, we have been talking about different types of papers, different types of journals, and citation index and impact factor. Thank you.